Good morning, Adonai Church. So good to be joining with you this morning to worship the Lord. We are already in the month of October. The Lord has led us these 9 months miraculously. If we are alive and if you are able to watch this video and worship the Lord, it is truly the Lord's protection, the Lord's faithfulness that we are here. And so this morning, even before we get on to singing and praising Him, why don't you just lift your voices up and say, Lord, thank you, Lord. Yeah, you can join with me and say, Lord, thank you. Thank you for being our shield, Lord, and our exceedingly great reward. Thank you for putting a wall of protection, providing for us, watching over us, pillar of cloud, pillar of fire. We give you all the praise, honor, and glory. Even as we worship you, may we encounter Jesus this morning, and that He might receive all praise and honor. In Jesus' name we ask this. And all God's people said, Amen, amen. Let's together worship the Lord this morning.
Lord of all creation, of the water, earth, earth and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. Universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are whole.
You're the Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Worthy is your name, Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Worthy is your name. You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I seek. You are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Worthy is your name. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Worthy is your name. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my only all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my only all. Jesus, you're the Lamb of God. Worthy is your name. Jesus, you're the Lamb. Worthy is are the worthy Lamb, Lord. Church, we rejoice in Him. We celebrate Him. We sing praises to this Almighty God because He is worthy, He is holy, He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, He is the Ancient of Days. But you know what? This Almighty God rejoices over you. He delights over you with singing and with dancing. A couple of days ago, even as I was getting the attention of my little baby girl, Jemima, who was about 5 months old, to get her attention, I started just singing. She was in this bassinet and I was just before her, just in front of her. And I started singing and I started dancing to just get her attention. I was just going dancing and singing and just to get her attention. And then when she saw me, she started giggling and she started laughing. And even as this exchange of singing and rejoicing was going on, I just remember this verse from Zephaniah 3:17. It says, "The Lord your God is in your midst. The Mighty One will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with His laugh. He will rejoice over you with singing." Even as I was doing that, I got a glimpse of this verse. That's how the Almighty God rejoices over you. Can you capture that? The God, the Almighty God of whom we just sang, "Worthy is the Lamb, you're the Lion and the Lamb, the Holy One." This Almighty God's eyes are upon you. He rejoices over you with singing. He delights over you. And even as I sat there thinking, oh, now that I know what it means that God rejoices over me with singing, then I asked myself, am I worthy of all this singing and rejoicing over me, Lord? Do I really deserve it? I felt the Lord telling me, you are my beloved. You are the apple of my eye, and I love you so much. You are the apple of His eye, church. Every person who's watching this video, do not disqualify. Do not write yourself off. You are the apple of His eye. He rejoices over you with singing, and He wants to quiet you with His love. Whether you feel like you are the apple of His eye or not, the truth is that God rejoices over you. He delights over you. Why don't you just take a moment and say, Lord, thank you, Lord. Probably you don't feel like the apple of His eye. A lot of things is not going the way it's supposed to be. But just take this moment to say, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord. The Lord your God is in your midst. The Mighty One. The one who rejoices over you. He will save you. Whatever circumstance you are in, He will save you. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with His love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies.
when all my fears are gone. He unravels me.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with the song of deliverance from my enemies. When all my fears are gone, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
Thank you, Lord.
I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear.
We are your children.
I am a child of God.
I'm no longer
a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins.
From my mother's womb.
From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Love has called my name.
You're born again.
I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave. Child of God,
I'm no longer
a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child.
In our midst, Lord, the mighty one will save us. You rejoice over us with gladness. You quiet us with your love. And you rejoice over us with singing, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for this assurance. Thank you for the confidence that we have, Lord, in you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you for being a Jehovah Jireh provider. You've been a good father to us, Lord, these 9 months, Lord, in the midst of this pandemic, Lord, you've continued to provide for us. We give you praise and honor, and we acknowledge you as our Daddy God. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Thank you, Lord, that people could put their trust and confidence in you, and you've been able to richly reward, Lord, each one of them, Lord. And even as they continue, Lord, I pray you will open the windows of heaven, and that you will bless them, Father God, financially, materially, for businesses, for every investments, Lord, people are, Lord, doing. There will be a rich harvest, Lord, this season. And that you will keep the devourer out of them, Father God. Even as they display their trust and confidence in you. And we choose to worship you even in our giving, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, Amen, Amen. God bless you. This is your opportunity to worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings. And even as you do that, there will be a song in the background. The details of the bank accounts will be up on the slide. God bless you.
To Good morning, Adonai family. I'm here to make a very, very important announcement. But before I do that, I'm aware that this month will be 7 months since we have not been fellowshipping together at our services. And I want to thank each and every one of you for the way you have stuck together, prayed for one another, supported one another during this very difficult time. I especially want to thank the cell group leaders for doing a wonderful job and walking the extra mile to be a blessing and an encouragement to the people. So from this October the 11th, we are opening our Sunday services to those who would like to physically attend Sunday morning services. But those of you who would like to continue watching the online services, you're welcome to be at home and watch the service. But please be connected with your cell group leaders, be connected with people and watch what's happening online every Sunday. So thank you so much for enduring. I know it must be in a difficult time for you all, staying at home, watching the services. But thank God we could look forward to better days even in the future. Now, there are certain guidelines I would like you to follow when we meet together on a Sunday morning. The first thing I want you to know that we will be having a registration form that we would like you to fill up, booking your seat so that we know how many people are attending. So please fill up that form. For first service, there's a form. The second service, there's a separate form. We are limiting the number of people for the service to 75 people. So the minute we cross that number 75, the registration form will not be there for you to fill in. So please don't wait for the last minute. Register your name and how many people are going to attend with you so that we keep a control on how many people attend our services each Sunday. Now, the second requirement is that you wear your masks. During the service, we would like you, we would prefer that you wear your masks. After the service, it's up to you. But during the service, if you can wear your mask, at least during worship, it'll be very, very important. Not just for you, but even for those who are attending. We would also like you to be sensitive to people who come. If you could practice a bit of social distancing, if people don't want to be hugged, be careful, don't hug them. If they don't want to shake your hands, don't be offended. Just be sensitive to people. Just greet people and let them know that you genuinely care for them, and that's why you're maintaining a measure of distance in the way you relate with one another. Especially if you don't know someone, please give them the space in the way they want to relate with you. I have requested our staff and all those on serving team to kindly wear the mask throughout. It's mandatory for our staff people, media team, all to wear their mask while they're present on the campus. So we create a safe place, a safe environment for us to enjoy God. And so I trust that you will abide by these guidelines so that we could move forward in a very positive way. And we trust that Sunday after Sunday, things will get better. So two services, register online, and we trust that you'll have a blessed time, and we will be watching what's happening. God bless you, and have a great service. As Philip brings the word this morning, I'm sure you will be blessed. And so take care, and we will see you shortly.
A very good morning, Adonai family. We'd like to welcome each and every one of you all with a lot of love. Thank you so much for joining us for our Sunday morning service. It's a privilege to have all of you all. I hope you enjoyed the worship. Now it's time for the word. Please put your hands together and welcome Brother Phillips as he brings the word for today morning.
A very good morning, a good afternoon, and a good evening to each one of the Adonai family from across the world. I know people are tuning in from different nations to watch the Adonai worship, and not only watch, but to be part of it and to be part of growing in the Lord as part of this family. Thank you very much for joining this morning, and we continue on the series of the book of Zechariah, which is part of the Minor Prophet series. And as you know, as I mentioned previously, we are doing an expository preaching and teaching. So I'll go a little bit slower, verse by verse, trying to understand what they mean. And I hope it'll help us to grow as we study this book and help us to give a different perspective of what God wants us to do. And as I encouraged you last week, I also want to encourage you now, if you are there, this is a Bible study kind of a thing. So go pick up a Bible and pick up a pen, pick up some notes. If you want to make some notes, it'll be of use for your reference for later, deeper study if you want to do on your own. So thank you again. I want to begin with this story about these two friends. They met together after a very long time. So this friend asked the other guy, "Hey, haven't seen you in a long time. What have you been up to these days?" So his friend answered and said, "Listen, I'm in a very nice job." So he asked, "What is it about?" He said, "I can shoot your mother-in-law, I can frame her, and I can hang her." So this guy was so confused. He's like, what kind of a job? Has this fellow become a militant or what? And then he inquired a little more. And that guy paused for a while and he answered. His friend said, "Listen, I'm a photographer. I shoot photographs and I frame people and I hang them on the wall. And that's my job." Why am I saying this? It's a joke, by the way. If you didn't laugh, please laugh. Why am I saying this? Sometimes communication can be very complicated. Unless we understand the right perspective and the right context, we can misunderstand the whole thing. The moment we use the word shoot these days or hang or frame, we think about some things that are negative because we're taking it in a certain context. So as we study the book of Zechariah, as we study the prophetic books or any part of the Bible, one of the most important things we need to understand is the context is the key to understand the scripture. If you remove the context, you will misunderstand, you will misrepresent. You need the content and you need the context. You need both of them as we go along. So as a church, I hope as we study this together that you will be able to understand what this means. In part 1 of Zechariah, in chapter 1, verse 1 to 5, 1 to 6, we looked at the title of "Refining Process Requires Continual Surrender." And under that, we looked at how God remembers us. As Zechariah is bringing this admonition, he's also bringing a message of hope. God remembers and God reminds the people to return to him. And finally, we looked at God's restoration call to break the pattern. And the last time we looked at chapter 1, verse 7 to 17, we looked at presence of Christ in our midst, prayer of Christ, and his passion for his people, Christ's passion for his people. As we looked at the first vision of the man among the myrtle trees, and we looked at what it meant. And as we go on, if you missed the series, if you want to get a little bit more context, I suggest that you go back to YouTube, search for Adonai Tube. You will find the series on Zechariah, and you can listen to the older series so that you will get a better understanding of what it is. Now, as we look at the book of Zechariah, one of the things that I mentioned last time is it's a complicated book because it not only talks about the current context in which Zechariah is, he's also talking about the future, the first coming of the Messiah. He's also talking about the second coming of the Messiah. And as we looked at it last time, he also speaks about the pre-incarnate revelation of the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And that's what is more important for us to understand. And we saw in verse 12 of chapter 1 how Jesus, who's referred to as the angel of the Lord, prays on behalf of Israel. And he says, "How long, O Lord?" And he reminds God, saying, it's already 70 years of exile that is over. And as a result of that prayer, God speaks in verse 13, comforting words, comforting words to Israel. And what are the comforting words? And verse 13 says, and the Lord answered gracious and comforting words to the angel who talked with me. And subsequent to that comes this eighth vision, this other seven vision. So the first vision happens and he gets this comforting word, and the rest of the vision sort of elaborate on this first vision and the comforting words that were spoken. If you remember, verse 15 we looked at, where God said as part of his revelation, and I'm very angry with the nations that feel secure. I only a little angry, but they went too far with punishment. We find God telling that he's angry with the nation. So the second vision that we are going to be looking at today is the vision that he's talking about how God brings his anger against the nations. So the vision relates to the nations. Let's read on. Today we are going to be looking at Zechariah chapter 1 verse 18 all the way to 21. And I was hoping to do chapter 2, the third vision also, but I'm not sure if time will permit us for that. But at least let's look in depth what chapter 1 verse 18 onwards. If you're with me, please read along loud if possible. It says, and I lifted my eyes and saw, behold, four horns. I'm going to read till 21, and we come back verse to verse, okay? And I said to the angel who talked with me, what are these? And he said to me, these are horns that have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem. And verse 20 reads this, then the Lord showed me four craftsmen. First were the four horns, and then there are the four craftsmen. And I said, what are these coming to do? He said, these are the horns that scattered Judah so that no one raised the head. And these have come to terrify them, to cast down the horns of the nation who lifted up their horns against the land of Judah to scatter it. That brings us to verse 21, how we find it is scattered. Let's now look at four horns and what it means, the four powers. Four horns, four powers. Before we look at that, let's look how verse 18 starts, the second vision starts. It says, and I lifted my eyes. You know, you will find this lifted my eyes by Zechariah repeated almost at every vision that he has, every of these eight visions. You know, it has a significance here. The significance is this. Some of us, because it is a night vision, we can mistake it to be a dream. Remember last time I said, dream is what you have when you are sleeping. Vision is what you have when you are awake. And Zechariah is very much awake and he's seeing this vision. It's as if he sees one vision, one revelation that comes to him. And he puts his eyes down and head down and he's sort of contemplating on the revelation that God has given. And immediately probably the angel nudged him and he lifts his eyes up. Because he's awake, he's seeing the vision that God is revealing. He lifts his eyes up. You can find this happening again and again. I won't go through each of them now, but as we look at different visions, we will look at each one of them. But important to note that he's very much awake and he's seeing this vision and he's lifting up his eyes. And what did he see? It says, and saw, and behold, four horns. See, he first says he saw, and then he says, behold. This word behold is not just an ordinary seeing. It's something that surprises Zechariah, something that shocks him. You know, we use the word behold just to express some kind of a surprise or some kind of an excitement. Behold, like John the Baptist told when he saw Jesus, he said, behold the Lamb of God. His disciples could immediately connect with what he was saying because of the fervency with which he was able to say. Similarly, Zechariah is so excited in a way, maybe surprised in a way. He says, behold. And what does he see? He sees four horns. Now, four horns is the horns of the animals that we are talking about here. Which animal horn this is, we do not know, but for us to understand that in the biblical imagery, whenever you read about horn, it represents something. What do horns represent? Horns represent power. They represent pride. They represent strength. They represent, you know, something of Gentile nations particularly, which talks about God raising up a horn or bringing low a horn to say how he raised up a nation or how he brought low a nation. So horn talks about power. Of course, we see other uses of the horn in the Bible. We see horn is used for anointing like Samuel did. Horn is used for blowing to declare a war or to close a war or to declare peace. Horn was used by Joshua when he marched around the Jericho walls, when the whole walls came crumbling down. So there was different other uses of horn, but typically, in the biblical imagery, you will find, even in Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, and Psalm 75, and Jeremiah 48, you will find horn being used as a symbol of power. Now, for many of us, why is it power? If you noticed animals fighting, especially animals with the horn, they will butt each other with the horn. And that's because that's a part of their strength. Now, we see a generations that never seen goats fight on the streets or oxen fight on the streets, except for National Geography. But I grew up in a generation which was local geography. So we could see animals fight one another and they will lock horns with each other. And if you've gone, sometime back I was in another Western country where they had this gaming restaurants. Gaming restaurants is where the people go hunting, they kill the animals and they serve those animals in the restaurant. And one of the symbols that they do is they put up the horns on the walls of the restaurant just to say how they overpowered the animal, that they're more powerful than the animal. So horns represents strength. It represents a nation. It represents power. Let's read verse 19. Verse 19 says, "And I said to the angel who talked with me," probably Zechariah knew what a horn means. He knew because he came from a culture where horn was being used for anointing and different other purposes. But he sees four horns together. So he's asking a question, "What are these?" And he said to me, "These are the horns that have scattered Judah, Israel, and Jerusalem." And commentators differ on what these horns mean. All of them agree this represents nations, four nations. But what the contention is, which are those nations? There are some scholars who believe that these nations represent the compass, north, east, west, and north, south, and east, and west. These nations, that enemy nations that surrounded Israel without naming them. That's one way of looking at it. The second set of people look at it and say, this represents Assyria that conquered the northern kingdom, Egypt, where people were under slavery, and Babylon and Medo-Persian Empire, the four nations that were there. But as we go along, we will see there's another interpretation to which I am inclined towards, and I agree because we will look in the scripture to see why this is true. This is to say, this is talking about four nations. First is Babylon, the one who was ruling right now when Zechariah is prophesying. They've been captured already. Then comes the Medo-Persian, under whose rule they came back to build the temple. We read that in the book of Haggai. They came back to build the temple and the Medo-Persian. And then came the Greeks. Greeks came and conquered the world. We look at the details in a little while now. And then came the Romans. And these are the four nations that I believe are represented by these four horns. Now, why do I say that? Let's look at it. But before I look at that, the interpretation also differs because of the word scattered. Because it sounds in English as if it is a past tense, they tend to think Zechariah is thinking of nations that were before him as scattered. But scholars agree, I'm no Hebrew scholar, but I borrow from the writings. Scholars agree the word scattered here is not a past perfect tense. It's talking about the present perfect tense. It can also mean a future perfect tense. So it doesn't mean this means in the past alone, but this can be in the future because God is giving a message of hope. It's not just about the past. It's not just about the current, but He's giving a message of hope for the future. And I want us to understand this. And for us to understand this, I will take us through some scriptures for us to understand this. Let's turn to Luke chapter 21 and verse 24. Luke chapter 21 and verse 24. Chapter 21 of Luke is a chapter where Jesus is talking about end times. He's talking about different signs that will happen, different events that will take place. And in verse 24, he says this. Listen to this carefully. It says, they will fall by the sword. This is what Jesus is saying, referring to the people of God. They will fall by the sword and will be taken as prisoners. That's disciples and those who trust in God to all the nations. Jerusalem will be trampled on by the Gentiles. Jesus is talking about in the futuristic view, trampled on by the Gentiles until, now listen to this carefully, until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Now what is this times of Gentiles that Jesus is talking about? It's a very interesting thing. As I studied further on this, I got to understand that until David conquered Jerusalem from the Jebusites. And after that was conquered, Jerusalem was conquered, it was always ruled by the Jews, always ruled by the children of God, always ruled by the Israelites, until Babylon came to the southern kingdom and they captured Jerusalem. And that marks the birth of the beginning of the times of Gentiles. And ever since then, Jerusalem has been ruled by other Gentile people over a time. And now Jerusalem is close to the heart of God. You will find this in the Psalms. You will find this in the writings that Jerusalem, even when He creates the new heavens, He will create a new Jerusalem that shows His presence, that signifies His people's epicenter of His presence. So there is something dear there. And when the times of Gentiles it's talking about the Gentiles ruling over Jerusalem. Many of you know, even right now, Israel, though it's a nation, only half of Jerusalem is ruled by Israel. The other half is ruled by the Palestinians. You will know this when recently Trump declared Jerusalem as the capital, there was a big uproar internationally. It's still under the times of Gentiles. Now, let's go on. When does this come out of the rule of Gentiles? Is when Jesus was born, partially it was fulfilled, but it will be fulfilled in its totality when Christ comes back and touches down on that Mount Olives and He defeats the enemy and He establishes His rule from Jerusalem to the whole world. And then will be the end of times of the Gentiles. Until it is fulfilled, Jesus is saying here, there will be persecutions, you will be put in prisons, there will be hardship. He is explaining to them and He's saying, because Jerusalem is under siege. Now, why do I say this? Let's read. I'm going to read a lot of verses from the book of Daniel. So I want you to follow through this. Daniel chapter 2. Well, I will read from verse 31 all the way up to verse 45. And I want you to follow this very carefully. Let me give you the context of this passage first. The context of the passage is, you know the story, most of us, Daniel and his friends have been taken into exile. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, has a dream. Now he calls his wise men and says, okay, tell me the interpretation. The wise men say, fair enough, king, tell us the dream. Nebuchadnezzar says, no, I will not tell you the dream, but I want you to tell me the dream and the interpretation. Of course, nobody is able to say that. They finally go to Daniel and his friends. Daniel calls forth his friends and says, you pray for me. And he goes in to pray. God gives him the revelation of what the dream was. He also gives him the revelation of what the interpretation was. So this verse 31 is beginning when Daniel is speaking to Nebuchadnezzar and he's telling him what Nebuchadnezzar dreamt about. This is where we start, verse 31. Your majesty, he's referring to Nebuchadnezzar. Your majesty looked, and there before you stood a large statue. Can you imagine a large statue? In India, we have many large statues coming up now. So imagine the large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. It must have really been huge. The head of the statue was made of pure gold. Its chest and arms of silver, and its belly and thighs of bronze. That's what we find. So this is not a uniform material statue. It's got different materials. Verse 33, its legs of iron and its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. That has a significance. We will look at that. Listen to verse 34. I love this. While you were watching, a rock was cut out, but not by human hands. It stuck the statue on its feet of iron and clay and smashed them. Verse 35 says this. Then the iron, clay, the bronze, the silver, and the gold were all broken to pieces and became like chaff on a threshing floor in summer. The wind swept them away without leaving a trace, but the rock that stuck the statue became a huge mountain and filled the whole earth. Beautiful thing, isn't it? Now, Daniel tells him the dream up to verse 35, 31 to 35, and from 36 onwards, he goes on to give what the interpretation is of that dream. Let's read it. Verse 36. This was the dream, and now we will interpret it to the king. Your majesty, you are the king of kings, and the God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. Verse 38, in your hands he has placed all mankind and beasts of the field and the birds in the sky. Wherever they live, he has made you a ruler over them all. And he goes on to tell Nebuchadnezzar, you are that head of gold in that statue. You are the head. So he's telling him that he is the head, that the kingdom is the golden era. And verse 39, he goes on to remind him of something else. He says this, after you, another kingdom will arise inferior to yours. Now, this is where he's referring to the Medo-Persian kingdom. And Zechariah is already experiencing that right now. Remember, this dream came as four kingdoms to Daniel when he is in exile. Few years later, when the exiles have returned and Zechariah is in the land, God is giving him a vision in Judah about four horns. They refer to the same. And first thing that he's talking about is the nation of Babylon. Second kingdom, which is inferior. I do not know why he says inferior, but it was more powerful than Babylon. But nevertheless, it says it's inferior. That's a Medo-Persian empire. Next, a third of the kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. This he is referring to the Greeks who conquered the Medo-Persian kingdom under the leadership of Alexander the Great. Now, Alexander the Great went on a rampage against the nation and he destroyed the nations and he conquered them. And Greeks went on to conquer much part of the then known world. So Daniel, when he is prophesying, he is in the time of the Babylonians. He does not know about the Medo-Persians. He does not know about the Greeks, but yet he is prophesying. Zechariah has experienced the Babylonians. He's experienced the Medo-Persians. Now he's looking to the future to say there are two kingdoms that are in the present and the past and two kingdoms that are in the future. And Greeks are one of those two kingdoms. Now, I should tell you that Greeks did not only rule militarily, they also ruled philosophically. Even today, the world's view, world's philosophy is influenced by much of what the Greek philosophers thought. They were the ones who influenced and conquered the world through their medicine, through their thought process. That's why in 1 Corinthians, when Paul addresses the mind, he's addressing this Greek philosophy that is there that says mind is central to man. Whereas the Jewish philosophy said heart is the central to man. So Paul is trying to address that there. Nevertheless, let's come back here. Verse 40. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things to pieces, so it will crush and break all. Verse 41, just as you saw the feet and the toes were partly baked of clay and partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom. Yet it will have some of the strength of iron in it, even as you saw iron mixed with clay. As the toes were partly iron and partly clay, so this kingdom will be partly strong and partly brittle. And just as you saw the iron mixed with baked clay, so the people will be a mixture and will not remain united any more than iron mixes with clay. Verse 44, and in the times of those kings, but let me dwell on the previous verse once now before. This is referring to the Roman government. This is referring to the Rome who went again on a rampage, conquered a greater part of the world than what the Medo-Persians had done or the Greeks had done. And now you'll realize that the Babylonians were conquered by Medo-Persians, and the Medo-Persians were conquered by the Greeks, and the Greeks were conquered by the Romans, but the Romans were not conquered, but still their kingdom disseparated. Why? Daniel gives an explanation here. Because they were mixed, their feet and their legs were mixed with iron and clay, and they were not united together. As a result of this disunity that came from within Rome, Rome got split and they were scattered, and there were no more a big, mighty superpower in the world. Now you find this so beautifully described by him, but he goes on to talk about another kingdom in verse 44. Daniel is talking, in the time of those kings, the God of heaven. Can you read that with me, please? It excites me when I read this verse. It says, in the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom. What will he set up? He will set up a kingdom. There are these four kingdoms that are there, but God says he will bring another kingdom. He will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed. The horns will be destroyed, but his kingdom will never be destroyed, nor will it be to another people. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end, but it itself will endure forever. Hallelujah. God's kingdom will endure forever. And there's something more in verse 45. It says, this is the meaning of the vision. The rock cut out of the mountain, but not by human hands. A rock that broke the iron, the bronze, the clay, the silver, and the gold to the pieces. What a beautiful, beautiful verse that talks about how God just broke everything and he is going to establish a kingdom. He is going to establish it in a way that we will rule and reign forever with Jesus Christ. And Jesus will establish that kingdom. So in one sense of it, this prophecy of Daniel and Zechariah was fulfilled during the birth of Jesus. When Jesus was born, and he lived 30 years, and when he began his ministry, you know and I know, one of the first things he spoke about, he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. The time is already gone. The time of the Gentiles is getting over. The kingdom of God is near. You need to repent and come into this kingdom. Do you see this picture? The kingdom of God is near. Now the Jews understood this very well because they knew the prophetic book. Disciples understood it very well because they knew the Jewish scriptures that were there. They understood it very clearly. That is why, even as late as Acts chapter 1, after Jesus' resurrection, when he is ascending to heaven, just before that they ask him, is this the time that you will establish the kingdom? Is this the time you will restore the kingdom? They understood it very well because they knew the Messiah is supposed to come to win the battle and to establish the kingdom. But the problem was, the kingdom that Jesus had in mind was not just an earthly kingdom, though he will establish an earthly kingdom that we will look at. But he is talking about a kingdom bigger than that. He's talking about a kingdom where he will rule and reign and he will be established. Partially it was fulfilled when Jesus came, first time. Second time when he comes, it'll be fully established when he touches down on that Mount Olives and he will speak the word to defeat the enemy, and the enemy will be bound and put into the pits of hell, and he will establish a throne in Jerusalem. He will establish a new heaven and earth, and he will establish a new throne and a new Jerusalem, and there his kingdom will be fulfilled. This prophecy will be fulfilled. His kingdom will be established. My friends, when I read this, it encourages me so much, because when I look at it, nations have come, nations have gone, but his kingdom will be forever and ever and ever. And I'd rather be part of this forever kingdom than to be part of a temporal kingdom that is there today and gone. And this prophecy that you see, this vision that Daniel is interpreting that you see, the vision that Zechariah saw of the four horns that you see, is not a year or a two or a three. It spans over hundreds of years. And in spite of that, we know that though the people went through trouble after trouble because of the times of Gentiles, and today the church is going through the trouble after trouble after trouble because of the time of Gentile, but yet there will come a day when Christ will come and he will establish his throne, and we will rule and reign with him forever. Time permitting, we will look at some of those verses to say how we will rule. Then he goes on in verse 20, chapter. Now we are back to Book of Zechariah. Book of Zechariah, chapter 1, verse 20. This is a dual vision. He has one vision about the horns, and then he sees another vision. And this is what he sees. Then the Lord showed me four craftsmen. And I said, what are these coming to do? He said, these are the horns that scattered Judah so that no one would be raised his head. And these have come to terrify them, to cast down the horns of the nation who lifted up their horns against the land of Judah and to scatter it. You know, the Lord shows Zechariah craftsmen. In fact, you will find different translations use different words for this. In fact, NKJV translates this as carpenters. Actually, it means in Hebrew, I'm told, somebody who's able to hammer well. They're called hammerers, okay? Or a skilled person, somebody who's able to do things with tools, somebody who's able to use to build, use to break, whatever, able to use skilled tools. We'll call them craftsmen here. And NIV and ESV also uses the same word, craftsman. And the Lord shows him four craftsmen, and Zechariah is puzzled. He's saying, what are these, my Lord? What have they come to do? And then the angel explains, saying that God is raising up a craftsman to destroy the horn that scattered Israel and Judah and Jerusalem. So for every horn that was raised, God is raising up a craftsman. So for four horns, there are four craftsmen. And each one of them is destroyed because of this craftsman that come. My friends, I do not know who are the people who are working against us right now. But I know this one thing, that God sees, and he's giving a prophetic vision to Zechariah saying, Zechariah, you've but seen two nations. You've seen Babylon, you've seen Medo-Persian, but you yet to see the nations that are to come. But even those nations which will be mighty in power because they have this horn of pride and strength, even they'll be subdued because of the craftsmen that God will raise. And I believe that God raised Medo-Persian for Babylon as a craftsman. He raised the Greeks as craftsmen for the Medo-Persian. He raised the Romans as craftsmen for the Greeks. So God is in the business of handling this thing for us. What do we learn from this? If you are not too interested in studying the scripture, looking only for application, here it is for you. What do we learn from this, my friends? You know, we learn to see that how many of us have lived with a microscopic view of life. In fact, I forgot to mention the title of this message. The title is Understanding the Big Picture. And many of us, when we live our lives, we live microscopic view lives. What do I mean by that? There is one small creature under that microscope. You are magnifying it. Your focus is only on that. You're seeing only that. You're missing the big picture that there is. And this can happen to us as a church. It can happen to us as believers. It can happen to Israel as a nation. What has happened? They're saying, you know, people say, this is mine. You know, me, mine, everything. You know, I heard somebody say, you know, me, my wife, my son and daughter, we four and no more. We live such selfish lives. Even in ministry sometimes, we forget that God did not come to establish you and me just in a building. He came saying, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. He is bothered about that kingdom to establish his reign in Jerusalem, to establish his reign in Zion, that is the church. What is he saying? He's saying, move out of this, my ministry, my church, my song, my house, my children, my work, my this, my that. Get out of that microscopic view and zoom out into the big picture to see how centuries after centuries after centuries, four different powerful superpowers came up, but they were all destroyed. And God has a plan for Israel, and He is fulfilling that big picture. And I want to tell us today that in our nation, there are people who are rising up against us. In our nation, there are communities that will rise up against the church. Church will go through persecution. Jesus told this in the early church. Early church testifies of the persecution, and everywhere where the church grew, there was persecution. But we get so focused on persecution, we forget the big picture, that God in and through the persecution, in and through the church, in and through the ministry, He's establishing His kingdom. He's bothered about establishing a kingdom for which He came and died on the cross of Calvary. Because that's the first message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. And many of the parables that He spoke about the kingdom of God, to compare it to a mustard tree or to compare it to different other things in His parables. Kingdom of God. Kingdom of God. And Jesus is interested in that kingdom of God. In fact, my attention was drawn to the Lord's Prayer. In the Lord's Prayer, when He taught them to pray, what did He say? Our Father in heaven, hallowed by Thy name, Thy kingdom come. First is the big picture. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. And then He goes down to say, give us this day our daily bread. When I say a kingdom view, I'm not undermining our individual needs. We will look at it in chapter 3 and chapter 4, how God is also bothered about individual. But first comes the kingdom view. Thy kingdom come, and then comes give us our daily bread. But very often, honestly, ask yourselves this question. How has your prayer life been? If we've been praying more for bread, more for the provisions of God, more for what we need in our lives, and you are just testifying, I prayed for this mobile, God gave me a mobile. I prayed for a car, God gave me a car. You are living a microscopic view. Praise God, He has provided. But He wants you to move beyond that to a view where you can say that God's big picture is the kingdom picture. And from that kingdom living comes the provision for our day-to-day living. Hallelujah. I hope you're grasping this. I hope you're able to see how the Lord's focus was on the kingdom. You know, it amazes me. I told this earlier and I don't mind repeating it again. When I look at the church, when I look at the nation of Israel, my faith in God is anchored. People have tried to destroy the church, destroy the Bibles. People have made statements saying we rid the nation of Christians. We'll rid the world of Christians. There were philosophers and communists who made a statement and atheists who said we'll get God out of heaven. They are gone, but God still continues to rule. Church still continues. Church still continues to grow. You know, on May the 14th, 1948, you know, before that, there was the Holocaust. Israel as a nation had been scattered. They did not even have an identity as a nation. They were scattered all across the world. And in Germany particularly, you know, that there was the Holocaust during the World War II, which started as early as 1933, and then it went on for a while. world thought the Israel has ended. World thought Jews have gone. World is rid of these Jews. That's what they thought. But listen to this. On May 14, 1948, David Ben-Gurion, the head of Jewish agency, proclaimed the establishment of the state of Israel. From nowhere, from Holocaust to an establishment of a nation. And on the same day, U.S. President Harry S. Truman recognized Israel as a nation. And from 1948 till now, Israel has been constantly fighting the battles against its enemies that surround her. But yet, the nations have come, nations have gone. Israel still continues to survive and move. Why? Because God has not lost the purpose of his kingdom and establishing them. My friends, governments will come, governments will go. Plagues will come, plagues will go. I can say viruses will come, viruses will go. But God's kingdom will rule and reign forever. So my question to you, my friend, is how is your living? Is your living a microscopic view living? Or are you living looking at the big picture, a kingdom-focused living? If you are microscopic-based living, I am sad for you because God has a greater purpose than that. Zoom out a little and say, God, what would you want me to do in your kingdom? And be used of God wherever God has placed you right now. Be used of God. Someone said this, Christian life is pictured as a warfare. That's where we have the armor of God. It's not a playground, it's a battleground. We will have to fight battles as Christians. Battles as what? Opposition from those that are around us. And sometimes it's also a battle from within, fighting off the sins. Like it says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, it says, the fleshly lusts which wage a war against the soul. We have to fight them off in order to say, Lord, how will I live that kingdom purpose living? How will I get my focus back on the kingdom? Moving away from me focus to kingdom focus. I will quickly read another dream that Daniel interpreted, which gives us a sense of such hope. It is in Daniel chapter 7, the dream that he interprets for Belshazzar, the king who succeeded Nebuchadnezzar. He says this, as I watched, this horn was waging war against the holy people, defeating them. And verse 22, I love this verse. It says, until the Ancient of Days came and pronounced judgment in favor of the holy people, the Most High, and the time came when they possessed the kingdom. Who possessed the kingdom? The holy people of God possessed the kingdom. Verse 27, then the sovereignty, power, and greatness of all the kingdoms under heaven will be handed over to who? Will be handed over to the holy people of the Most High. And listen to this. Read along, please, loudly with faith proclaiming, his kingdom will be an everlasting kingdom and all rulers will worship and obey him. This is where Paul says, where every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Daniel is already speaking about it in the Old Testament. His kingdom is a kingdom that's forever and ever. I didn't go into all the verses in that dream. Please go back and read. It will encourage you to see, no matter what you see happening around you currently, no matter how tough the situations are for us as a nation, no matter how the wrong influences are taking over our nation, it does not matter, because kingdom of God is something that will be established. And the beauty is, you and me will be ruling together with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. No wonder we are a royal priesthood. No wonder we are called as the princes. No wonder we are called to wear the crowns. We will see that in chapter 3 when we look at it. How Joshua was crowned though he was a priest. But the beauty is to understand, my friends, that you and me will rule and reign with Jesus Christ. And his kingdom will last forever. What's the takeaway for us from this vision of the four horns and the four craftsmen? What we saw, the four horns refers to the four nations. And the four craftsmen are raised up, the nations that are raised up, to destroy the four horns that have been raised up because they scattered Judah and Jerusalem and Israel. And God is angry with these nations, as he told in verse chapter 1, verse 15. And he's scattering them now. And he's giving a message of hope to Zechariah, giving a message of hope to Judah, saying, though for a while these kingdoms may rule and reign, ultimately, kingdom belongs to me. Ruling and reigning belongs to me. And my holy people are going to rule along. We can also understand this, that God is our defender. I don't know who's against you today, but understand this one thing. For every horn that raises up, God raises up a craftsman. God raises up a hammerer who will destroy the one that raises up against you. He is our defender. He is our defender. He will do anything in order to destroy those who try to destroy you. We need to understand that God is in control. No matter what happens, all we have to do is zoom out from our microscopic view and say, God, here I am. I want to have a mindset of a kingdom mindset. I want to live my life, Lord, in a way that it will focus on the kingdom, not just on my own personal need. There's nothing wrong, my friends, in focusing. Jesus himself taught. But what we are saying is, how's your priority? Are you talking about hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come first, and then come to give us this day our daily bread? Or is it turned around that when you get the bread, then you think of the kingdom? It should be the other way around, to say, first I think of the kingdom, then the bread comes. That's why Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. What are we seeking? It's a question I can't answer for you. I can only answer for myself and my family. This is a question you got to ask yourself. Even as you get this message of hope and the turmoil, to know, God, I will obey, to live a life that is kingdom mindset life. And believe me, Jesus said this. He said, for I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And all of us can say, amen and amen. Gates of hell will never prevail against the church of God, because he is establishing it and he is going to do it. I'm going to request Charles now to come and sing a song. It's a song of proclamation of how God reigns. It's a song by Ron Kinnolly called Ancient of Days. Some of us may know it by Blessing and Honor, Glory and Power. Charles will lead us in this song. And after that, I'll request Charles to close in prayer. May I once again ask you to become a kingdom-focused person and not a self-focused person. And to understand that God is in control of you no matter what you are going through. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days.
Blessing and honor.
Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away. O Ancient of Days.
Blessing and honor.
Blessing and honor, glory and power
be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. We bless you, Lord. Exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days.
Thank you, Lord, for speaking to us and inspiring each one of us through your amazing word, Lord. We thank you that you're a God who speaks to us. Lord, our prayer is that everything that's been spoken would bring conviction, would bring restoration, and people, whoever hears your word, will be able to put those things into practice, Lord. Lord, we totally rely on your Holy Spirit to help us, Lord, to walk in this great understanding of your word, Lord. We thank you for speaking to each one of us. In Jesus' name we ask this. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.
Trust you are blessed with the word. Now it's time for the announcements. So we have our very first announcement, the marriage living free. So on the 4th of October at 6 p.m., we are going to have the marriage living free on Zoom. We'd kindly request you to invite married couples, those who are going through struggles in their relationships. And as the theme also suggests, those who are carrying a lot of baggages. I hope you like the poster design. And the poster design relates that how many people carry a lot of baggages in their marriage and how you can offload these baggages. The gospel also will be presented in the Marriage Living Free. Kindly invite your friends and your family members. You see the website link online, so you could send that link to them so that they can register for the Marriage Living Free. You could also share our creatives and our posts from Facebook and Instagram, and you would see that link on the screen right now. Again, thank you so much, church, for helping us taking the word out. Now I kindly request Charles to announce the third banns of marriage between Juliet and Harish.
I am pleased to publish the third and final banns of marriage between Juliet Cecil Edwards, daughter of Mr. Cecil James Edwards and Mrs. Jessica Cecil Edwards, with Harish, son of Mr. Ramu M. and Mrs. Bhagya. If there's anything against them that they should not be joined together in holy matrimony, kindly declare it in writing. This is the third and final time of asking.
Thank you, Charles, for announcing the banns of marriage. Hope all of you all enjoyed the service this morning. I would also like to take this opportunity right now to welcome the newcomers. So if this is your very first time joining us online, viewing our service, we kindly request if you could stay connected with us. We'd like to get to know you. There's a link you'd see on the chat box or on your TV screen. Type in the link or click that link. Give us some information where we can connect with you, pray with you, and get to know more about you. You can also join us live. We have a live link, which we call the Adonai Launch. It's a Zoom link, which you'll see in your chat box. If you'd like to meet with us, get to know more about us, please click on that link, and our team will be online, and we'll be happy to fellowship with you. Again, thank you so much, everyone, for joining us this morning. God bless you, and have a great week ahead.